morning and welcome to this beautiful day. In honor of spring, please join us in your hearts, not singing out loud, with our hymn, Morning Has Broken.
Entirely. Will you introduce our song again, Cathy?
Good morning, everyone. Our song for this morning in celebration of the vernal equinox is Morning Has Broken.
And please rise in body or spirit. If you're here in the room, you're welcome to sing with your hearts and your arms and your fingers and your toes, but not forcing the air out of your lungs. We'll just be singing in spirit here in the room, but at home, please sing along.
Morning has broken.
Good morning. Our opening reading is from Psalm 23 for this moment by Reverend Kevin Tarsa. Just when the weight of the world I inhabit threatens to drop me in place and press my hope down on the ground beneath me, love invites me to rest for a gentle while, sets me once again on its tender and demanding path. I know that all will be well. Good morning to everyone, both online and in person. I want to welcome all of you to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Manhattan, Kansas. I am Cathy Hedge, your convener today. As the vernal equinox brings us buds and sunshine, so all of you bring life to our fellowship. No matter if you are here for the first time or for a lifetime, you are welcome here. No matter your origins, backgrounds, who you are, or who you love, you are welcome here. Each of you brings your knowledge, your heart, your joys and sorrows. So thank you for being here, for all are welcome here.
Thank you, Cathy. My name is Pastor Isabel Call, and I serve as the minister here at the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Manhattan. We are trying out something new this morning, having our convener up there on the screen. So welcome, Cathy. Welcome, everyone online. And if you're joining us on Zoom, there will be a time later when we will be projecting your faces up there during joys and sorrows. So I'll let you know. And if you don't want to be present in the room like that, you're welcome to turn off your camera then. So this is the time in our service set aside to acknowledge the land upon which we gather, the people who lived interdependently with this land before our arrival, and their descendants unwillingly dispersed elsewhere. Let's take a moment to disentangle our hearts from the habits of control that give rise to enclosing land and excluding people from the gifts of life on this planet. This afternoon at 4 p.m., the racial justice team will be gathering on Zoom to consider how to connect this land acknowledgement to meaningful action. Anyone is welcome to join us. And now we're going to do the chalice lighting, and I invited someone up to help me while Cathy does the reading.
Our chalice lighting is "We Light This Flame as an Act of Faith," by Reverend Scott Taylor. We come with our doubts, worn out and worn down, wanting once again to trust, to believe that hope is not as fragile as it sometimes seems, that division is not as deep as it sometimes appears. And so we light this flame as an act of faith, a reminder, a redeclaration, a rekindling of the trust that darkness can't ever shut out the light, that kindness is more powerful than we know, that humility and accountability allows us to change, that together we can most certainly bend the arc of this beautiful universe towards justice.
And now I invite forward Les Lotchke, who will be giving us a stewardship reflection. Right on time. So this month is our stewardship campaign, and we have a number of people coming to share their reflections. We've also been doing gatherings so that people can get together and chat with each other about what they receive from the fellowship and what they have to offer. So if you haven't had a chance to have a conversation about the gifts you receive and give to the fellowship, let me know, or let our stewardship chair, Chris Bailey, over here know. We can connect you to people to talk to. So Les, come on up.
Oh, that's okay. All right, can people hear me well? All right. So, thank you, Pastor Issa, for asking me to share this stewardship reflection. And I enjoy being a part of the UUFM most because of all the people in the UUFM in our congregation. I enjoy talking, learning, and exploring life with all the folks that in our congregation that I've gotten to know. And that has made me want to be actively involved in the UUFM. So over the last 7 years that I've been in the UUFM, I've discovered that there are a wide variety of opportunities to become involved, and all while learning new and interesting things. So I've greeted people on Sunday, I've served them coffee, and chatted with folks while I was doing that, and gotten to learn about their lives. And then doing something like helping cleaning out the gutters was a way that I got to enjoy getting out in the fresh air with a new friend, and also learning new and interesting things, like the fact that about our gutters, that sometimes squirrels build nests in them. And then giving reflections on Sunday at Sunday services has given me the joy of sharing ideas that I'm fascinated by, and then discovering new ideas from folks in the UUFM, from their questions and their thoughts and reactions to my reflections. And working with a team of folks on the Sunday Services Committee, I've learned that every part of a Sunday service involves somebody's thought and care. And that was something that I had completely taken for granted before. And then serving on the UUFM board for a year, I learned about all the many, many different decisions that have to be made, you know, on a continual basis to keep the UUFM going. And then working with several groups to come up with a new vision statement for the UUFM, I learned about the aspirations and goals of our fellowship. And working with several different medical professionals in our congregation on the COVID advisory panel, I've learned about a number of different factors involved in pandemic safety and how those intersect with running a church. Most recently last week, facilitating a small group discussion on stewardship, I learned about several of my friends, things that they love about the UUFM, things that they think could be improved, and things that they hope that we'll do in the future. So all of these activities have drawn me closer to the people in the UUFM. And each year, Mickey and I make a pledge that makes us feel good about helping keep the UUFM going while doing so within our financial means. And I've enjoyed doing all these things as my small part of stewardship of the UUFM, which so many members have contributed so much to over the years and now. And those are all things that I can do, and many things that I've learned, new things that I've learned how to do, and that I enjoy doing. So most importantly, working with people across a range of ages, genders, and backgrounds has allowed me to meet and get to know so many people, so many great people that I would not have otherwise, and to learn so many new and interesting things. And that makes my life more enjoyable, more active, more fulfilling, and it makes me thankful that we have created this thing that is composed of all of us through the years that we call the UUFM. My pleasure.
Thank you, Les. Our reading for today is very interesting. There are two main versions of Sojourner Truth's speech that we often see as, "Ain't I a Woman?" The original was delivered on the Women's Rights Convention in Akron, Ohio on May 29th in 1851. And it was transcribed by a journalist, Marius Robinson, who actually was in the audience at the time of the speech. 12 years later, a Francis Gage changed most of Sojourner Truth's words and falsely attributed a Southern slave dialect to Sojourner's version. Robinson, however, and Sojourner Truth were good friends, and it's documented that the two of them worked on the final edition before it was published in the Anti-Slavery Bugle in June 21st in 1851. And so I thought you might enjoy reading that as we search for justice and the origin and one of the earliest pieces of women's rights in our national literature. May I say a few words? I want to say a few words about this matter. I am a woman's rights. I have as much muscle as any man and can do as much work as any man. I have plowed and reaped and husked and chopped and mowed, and can any man do more than that? I have heard much about the sexes being about the sexes being equal. I can carry as much as any man and can eat as much too, if I can get it. I am as strong as any man that is now. As for intellect, all I can say is, if women have a pint and man a quart, why can't she have her own little pint full? You need not be afraid to give us our rights for fear we will take too much, for we can't take more than our pint will hold. The poor men seem to be in all confusion and don't know what to do. Why, children, if you have women's rights, give it to her and you will feel better. You will have your own rights and they won't be so much trouble. I can't read, but I can hear. I have heard the Bible and learned that Eve caused man to sin. Well, if women upset the world, do give her a chance to set it right again. The lady has spoken about Jesus, how he never spurned woman from him, and she was right. When Lazarus died, Mary and Martha came to him with faith and love and besought him to raise their brother. And Jesus wept, and Lazarus came forth. And how came Jesus into the world? Through God who created him and woman who bore him. Man, where is your part? But the women are coming up. Blessed be God, and a few of the men are coming up with them. But man is in a tight place. The poor slave is on him. Women is coming on him, and he is surely between a hawk and a buzzard. Blessed be ye for hearing on me, and now old Sojourner ain't got nothing more to say. Hope you enjoyed that. And now we have our next hymn, If Every Woman in the World, and this will be supplied by video by Renee.
Nation.
delightful. Now it's our time for all ages, and Sandy Nelson is going to read She Persisted by Chelsea Clinton.
Anybody who wants to come up can come up. Does this work? Can you hear me? Am I on? Nod or not? Just... Now is it on?
Yeah.
It is? Do I have to do something to turn it on?
I think it is on.
Say that again. Oh, that sounded better. Does that sound better? Okay. Wow, I was having the struggle there, wasn't I? Thank you for joining me, Claire and Gigi. We are going to read She Persisted on the assumption that Doug gets our slides up. Tell me when they get up there, okay? You can lay on your back and look. Sometimes, oh, by Chelsea Clinton. Sometimes, can you see okay? Sometimes being a girl isn't easy. At some point, someone probably will tell you no. Thanks. At some point, someone will probably tell you no, will tell you to be quiet, may even tell you your dreams are impossible. Don't listen to them. These 13 American women certainly did not take no for an answer. Oh, wow. That was exciting, wasn't it? They persisted. Harriet Tubman. Harriet Tubman was born a slave, and her, this is hard to read, sorry, and her story could have ended there. Instead, she persisted, escaping from slavery and becoming the most famous conductor on the Underground Railroad. She risked her life many times to lead countless slaves to freedom, including her family, friends, and strangers. Every person she led to freedom arrived safely. Helen Keller. Once Helen Keller became blind and deaf as a toddler, few people thought she'd be able to learn to read, write, or speak. She persisted. Helen learned how to do all three, and not only became the first person with deaf blindness to graduate from college, but she used her story to help fight for more opportunities for people with disabilities in the United States and around the world. Do you know what that's called? It's like a cap and gown when she's graduating from college. Clara Lemlich. Can you see the pictures behind me on the wall? After her family fled poverty and the threat of violence in Ukraine for a new home in New York City, Clara Lemlich got a job working at a garment factory. She wrote that the factory's conditions made women into machines, and so she persisted, organizing picket lines and strikes that ultimately helped win better pay, shorter hours, and safer working conditions for thousands of workers, both women and men. Nellie Bly. Say that again. Nellie Bly became a reporter in part because male writer had said that working women were a monstrosity, and she wanted to prove that women could do anything, at times putting her safety at risk. She persisted throughout her career in exposing real monstrosities, pretending to be a sweatshop worker and a patient in a mental hospital to show how badly people were being treated. Virginia Apgar, inspired from an early age by her brother's childhood illnesses, Virginia Apgar was determined to be a doctor long before many girls had such dreams. Even though she qualified to be a surgeon, the male head surgeon at her hospital discouraged her because she was a woman. Nevertheless, persisted. Becoming an anesthesiologist and creating the Apgar score to test a newborn baby's health, which hospitals over the world still use today. Is that the baby? Maria Tallchief. After Maria Tallchief's family moved to California, partly to support Maria's dreams of becoming a ballerina, she was teased by students in school for her Native American heritage, and later was encouraged to change her last name to something that sounded Russian, since many professional dancers at the time were from Russia. She persisted, ignoring all the taunting and poor advice, to become the first great American prima ballerina. Claudette Colvin. As a 15-year-old riding a bus home from school in Montgomery, Alabama, Claudette Colvin was expected to give up her seat to a white woman just because she was African American. In her refusal to get up, she persisted in taking a stand for what's right, helping to inspire Rosa Parks to make the same choice 9 months later, an act many point to as starting the modern civil rights movement. Ruby Bridges. When Ruby Bridges was in kindergarten, many schools across America, particularly in the South, still refused African American students their equal right to an education. Ruby wouldn't be treated like a second-class student, and she persisted, walking for weeks past angry, hateful protesters to integrate an all-white elementary school in New Orleans. There she is walking. Margaret Chase Smith. As the first woman to serve as both a U.S. representative and a U.S. senator, Margaret Chase Smith could have let that fact alone be her legacy. Instead, she persisted in championing women's rights and more opportunities for women in the military, standing up for free speech, and supporting space exploration. The head of NASA once noted that we wouldn't have put a man on the moon without Margaret. What's your question? What does persisted mean? You know what? We're going to talk about that after we're done with the story. Sally Ride. Sally Ride always believed women could succeed in any math or science career, although not everyone agreed. She persisted, and she became the first American woman in space. But that wasn't enough for Sally. She traveled into space once more and then created science and engineering programs specifically for girls, so she could help generations of young women achieve their dreams too, both on Earth and in outer space. Florence Griffer Joyner. Does she look like a runner? Florence visited her father in the Mojave Desert. He would urge her to run faster and faster, to run as fast as a jackrabbit. Even when he had to leave college to help support her family, she persisted in her training on the track, then went back to school and got faster and faster. Her unbroken world records on the 100-meter and 200-meter sprints set at the 1988 Summer Olympics means she is still the fastest woman ever. Oprah Winfrey. Oprah Winfrey's grandmother expected Oprah to follow in her footsteps and become a maid. Oprah knew, even as a little girl, that her dreams would take her somewhere else. She persisted in turning those dreams into her reality and became a media superstar, working on movies, books, magazines, theater, and most of all, television, where Oprah Winfrey Show remains the highest rated talk show of all time. Sonia Sotomayor. Watching fictional judges on television inspired Sonia to want to be a real life judge when she grew up. She knew she spoke English as well as she spoke Spanish, study hard in school, and manage her diabetes before she could one day wear a judge's robe with a gavel in hand. She persisted, eventually becoming a Supreme Court justice and the first ever Latina to sit on America's highest court. Because I think it's fun to look at. So if anyone ever tells you no, if anyone ever says your voice isn't important or your dreams are too big, remember these women. They persisted, and so should you. I think that it's obvious we need to persist being children and go be kids. What do you say? Does that sound like fun? All right, let's go.
Thank you, Sandy, and your lovely audience. Like most children on this planet, I believe my family was just as it should be, normal, just like everyone else. So it was no surprise one particular Sunday when my beloved grandpa sat down his newspaper and pulled me onto his lap. We often read the funnies together, but this day he was serious. I can still remember the light playing on his strong Germanic face, his white flat-topped hair and dark eyebrows. This man, born in the 1890s, turned me to face him and he said, "Kathy Jean, don't you ever let anyone tell you you can't do something because you're a girl." I was no more than 5 years old, yet I thought, why would someone say that? Still, Grandpa Burrell made me promise, and I nodded my head, "I promise." Then we settled in to read Little Lulu and Henry. Henry was easy, just pictures. His request seemed perfectly reasonable. After all, my mother was a force to be reckoned with, a registered nurse, choir director, and the first ever woman president of the local Moose Lodge. And my daddy was a nurturing, patient man who took great joy in mom's adventures. After my dad died, mom said, "I want you to tell your sisters I could do what I did because your father was my rock." I thought that was the way it was supposed to be in a loving family. But when I stepped outside our front door, supposed to be just wasn't so. As a child, I saw our next door neighbor, middle-aged, childless, drinking all day, all alone, unrelentingly sad. Her husband wanted her in her place at home in case he decided to drop by. I heard the ladies at the Moose Lodge called Mrs. Bill Norris, Mrs. Phil Heisterman, Mrs. insert male name here, and I couldn't understand. I thought Kathy Jean was just a perfectly fine name and wanted to keep it. I saw a woman at Mass pull her veil over her left eye and swollen lip. I thought she must have had an accident. And until I saw the other women look at her strangely, as if she should be ashamed. And I was confused. In 1965, I moved to Northern Louisiana. When I raised my hand in class, some teachers never called on me. not once, all year. The girls castigated me for trying. One told me, girls don't do that here. The boys don't like it. And again, I figured, well, that was just because it was the Deep South. But no siree. In high school, I was in Coffeyville, Kansas, and my counselor refused to sign me up for physics. He said it was a boys' class. I argued, so he let me take chemistry. There was another girl. The two of us sat in the back row. And no, not once did the teacher ever call on me. And that was, of course, in Kansas. And when the time came for me to apply to college and to scholarships, the counselor refused to give me the applications. He said, you don't need that. There's a perfectly good community college right here. So I had to get the applications from my boyfriend at the time. Yikes. But still, I had a grandpa's spirit whispering in my ear, don't you ever let anyone tell you. I was a child of privilege, not financially, but my family assumed I'd go to college and they assumed I'd have a career. And mom would lecture us, both the boys and the girls in the family, you have to, it's your God-given talent. And so when I went off to college in 1969, I finally heard the words that described my mom, my dad, my grandpa, and finally myself, a feminist. It felt comfortable, like a plaid flannel shirt. I was living in a scholarship hall with 50 women, many of them leaders in the campus movements. I was a Watkins woman, and I proudly wore a red sweatshirt with a raised fist centered in the symbol for women. I assumed that soon the world would see clearly and that we'd all have our kumbaya moment and women would be equal partners, because after all, the Equal Rights Amendment was going to pass, right? It passed Congress with bipartisan support far exceeding the two-thirds majority required in March 1972, and Kansas signed on in the very first year. That was 50 years ago. Yet, we are still fighting for equity, but not just for white women lucky enough to go to college. Finally, the struggle has uncovered the whole spectrum of those undervalued and invisible in our culture. We see the pernicious waste of our God-given talents, as my mom would say, and we are not alone. I stand alongside all of you, my UU family. We don't just yearn for things to be better. We are taking action, even when it feels like we tilt at windmills. And together, I see great hope. And now, I'm a grandparent. My grandchild, age 15, is trying to determine their place on this planet. I see a person who's compassionate, curious, intelligent, and loving. Everything I hoped my grandchild would be, and very much like his mother, Amy. At 15, my grandchild, who still goes by he, is a feminist, like his Uncle Joey, like his grandfather, David, like his great-grandpa, Joe, and like his great-great-grandpa, Burrell, like his mother and me. So when life tries to shove him into a gender lane with high, impassable sides, my grandchild will refuse. If anyone dare say, you can't do that because you're a girl or a boy, I hope my grandchild's answer will be, yes, I can, because my grandma told me so. Thank you. And now we will have our offering.
Thank you so much, Cathy. Really lovely story.
Thank you.
So now's the time for our offering. And this month, it's our collections are going to the Wonder Workshop, which is a place here in downtown Manhattan for kids to come and explore and be themselves. You can make a contribution to the Wonder Workshop by putting your offering in the basket in the back, or going to our website, uufm.net/donate, I believe, and there are options there for you to select where you want your money to go. All of our undesignated contributions go to our special fund. So this week, this month, the Wonder Workshop. I'd also like to invite you to use this time to share your joys and sorrows. You can write on the paper near you here in person, or you can type it into the chat and Cathy will read it later. Could I have a volunteer here in the space to pick up the papers after people write on them? Thank you, Les. Lovely. So let's hear from Renee, Girl on Fire. Thank you, Renee. So I received one joy here, extreme joy. This is from Rob Morrison, that age 68, my mom finally put in her 2-week notice to retire. Congratulations, mom. Applause. Cathy, what have you to share?
We have some nice pieces here. Jane Pelletier shared that our friend, our friend Ruth Friedman will celebrate her 96th birthday on Friday. So that's a joy. And then Katie said, like Cathy Hedge shared a reflection. I always think the world, the U.S. cultural juggernaut will start to see clearly. That's bittersweet. It's a bittersweet, a joy and a sorrow. And then from Judy, many of us were blessed to see Sybil and Dave yesterday and honor them in person. So happy anniversary and happy birthday. Thank you.
We also share a sorrow in our community. We lost one of our own this week, Yvonne Lacey. She's not living here anymore, but is so close in our hearts. And many people have been sharing memories of her and love for her and her family. Her family members' addresses have been sent out. So if you want to reach out to them, that's welcome. Is there anything else we should share, Cathy?
I believe that's it. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'll just take a few breaths, holding these sorrows, these joys, and everything else that remains unspoken in our hearts. All right. Can you all hear me all right? Great. Thank you, Doug. So we're trying out something new, and I'm just so excited to have with us here my friend and colleague, Ann Wiesner. So I think you all can see her up there. Yes. So Ann identifies as an organizer, a strategist, a feminist, and a laundress. I've had the pleasure of working with Ann through my service on the board of directors of the Unitarian Universalist Women's Federation. Ann joined us as our executive director over a year ago. She came to us with decades of experience helping nonprofits and advocacy groups clarify their goals, build systematic models for social change, and infuse engagement and collaboration in their organizational culture. So Ann is an expert facilitator, which I have experienced, and it's just been a joy to work with her. Now, since we've been hearing about women and aspects of their full lives, I wanna just share some more of her bio that she shared with me. Ann got her commitment to community from her mother, who is a nurse and lifelong volunteer, her love of a good meal and robust political debate from her father, who first ran for office when Ann was in grade school, her comfort with risk and people from all walks of life working as a bartender in Las Vegas, and her sense of humor from living on this wacky, broken, hilarious, heartbreaking, and inspiring planet. So this is Ann Wiesner, and welcome, Ann. A wave, everybody. I don't know if you probably can't see everybody in the sanctuary, but I can see.
No, I can't.
So I wanted to just start our conversation off by talking about the hymn we sang earlier. If every woman in the world had her mind set on freedom, there would be no war. Renee, our music director, and I talked about this, and she was kind of on the fence about including it. She said it's sort of victim blaming. So I wonder, Ann, what you thought of that hymn.
Yeah, well, I love this sentiment of committing to creating a different and more peaceful world. I think the part that was challenging for me about that hymn was that I think it's going to take more than that. I think it's going to take more than us dreaming and visioning in order to get there. And I think the other thing I noticed about it is it talked about all of us doing the same thing, men and women. And I think we all have different roles to play in dismantling patriarchy. And so I think it's a little bit messier than that and a little bit, more complicated than that. But I love the idea of, you know, all of us committing in a really concrete way.
Yeah, there's a way that it minimizes what we are coming to understand, that white supremacy is really at the root of all of our conflict. Yeah. And also the song is steeped in the gender binaries. It lists men and then women, as if humanity fits into these two categories. Like we're somehow the same. But I chose the song because I think it's powerful to sing a song that starts with women, with naming women, even as we critique the gender binary. And it's a conversation we're having a lot at the UU Women's Federation is, what do we do now that we're becoming aware that the gender binary is an illusion and there's potential to outgrow it? I don't know. Would you share some of your thoughts about that?
You know, I think it's interesting because we have been having a lot of this conversation at the Women's Fed about what does it mean in recognizing gender fluidity and gender expansiveness, that does that make being a woman less powerful or less meaningful? And I don't think that's the point. I don't think the point is to abandon your strong identity as whatever gender you identify. I think instead it's really to break us out of these boxes that we build around these ideas and the sort of either or mentality of it. I love being a woman, and I don't think that diminishes someone who doesn't identify as a woman. But I do think that we have to create more space for understanding gender as a spectrum, or more than just one of two choices.
Yeah. Yeah, this is definitely an area of growth for me and for the Women's Federation. And what I'm finding as I think about it and is just a sense of appreciation and awe with the people, especially young people who are dispensing with the gender binary or finding identity as non-binary. And I'm learning to look up to their leadership as I still continue to identify strongly as a woman. And as I still kind of wonder, what does that mean? So I started out as sort of the prompt for the service was the question, what does it mean to be a woman today? And what does it mean to be a feminist? So I'll throw that question to you, Anne.
Yeah, I mean, I think an interesting question that's embedded in there is, what are the trends or shifts that we're seeing in the world as it relates to gender, and what does that mean for dismantling patriarchy or ending oppression of women? Like, that's, to me, I think a lot about what these shifts or changes or trends that we're seeing, what they mean for ending oppression. That's more interesting to me than what they mean for being a woman, I guess. I don't know if that makes sense, but.
Yeah. Yeah, these systems of oppression are operating against women, but they intersect. They're operating against all kinds of people in ways that intersect with being a woman, but intersect with all kinds of other identities. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. One of the things that came up in our conversation was the term womanism. I wonder, are folks here familiar with womanism? I see some heads shaking here. I can't see everybody on Zoom. So womanism is a movement, a theory that came to us from Alice Walker. She wrote that womanist is to feminist like purple is to lavender. So womanism is the centering of women's experience and women's culture, and it is embraced by Black women who understand that feminism has historically centered white women's experience and excluded women of color. And I feel like we can sort of get the sense of that from the piece by Sojourner Truth, you know, and that sort of the way that a white woman messed with it and wasn't centering Sojourner Truth's actual message and experience. So Alice Walker said, you know, womanism isn't better than feminism. It's just sometimes we need a new word when the old ones aren't helping us see and grow. Womanism has been coming up in our work at the UU Women's Federation. Wonder if you could speak to that, Anne.
Sorry, you glitched just a little bit. Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, how is womanism showing up in our work at the UU Women's Federation, which is a historically feminist organization?
Yeah, that's a great question. This is something we've been thinking a lot about and trying to expand our perspective. And I think that it starts with really opening up space and making more room for people whose experiences and worldview are different than ours. And in order to do that, we actually have to be in relationship with people whose experience and worldview is different than ours, right? And we have to listen more than talk. And so, you know, for me, in thinking about how social change happens, one of the things that I've observed over the last 10 years is that a lot of the current movements for liberation are being led by young queer women of color. They get appropriated all the time by other folks, but that's where the leadership is coming from. And how they think about making change is different than how maybe I've thought about it or how previous movements have thought about it. And so I think for me, I want to learn from that. I want to listen to that. And we are doing a lot of reflection about how we can learn from those things and listen to those things at UUWF. But I also, you know, think it means that for those of us who've had privilege or had access to leadership, we also need to get out of the way. And that, again, means, you know, maybe not being the first people to speak or stand up or take the space up and leave that space for other folks. And one of the things that we've been thinking about too is just what are the things about how we work together that perpetuate white patriarchy, white supremacy and patriarchy. And so one of the things that we've been doing is rethinking how we actually conduct business on a day-to-day level. Because if we're not being inclusive and expansive and collaborative in our daily workings, then we can't really be that way out in the world. And so, you know, we've been doing things like rejecting the use of Robert's Rules of Order, which is a, you know, sort of a, like a mini lifelong campaign of mine to get rid of Robert's Rules of Order, because I think it's suppressive and hierarchical and patriarchal, and it's designed to prevent people from participating.
We've got laughter here in the sanctuary.
I'm sorry?
We've got laughter here in the sanctuary.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, a lot of people laugh at me when I talk about this, but I actually think it's a big deal. If you go to a school board meeting, for instance, and you want to speak about your child's education, you have to be able to navigate these complicated, antiquated rules that were invented by a military guy in the 1800s. And that's problematic. And we've also been talking about governance, like what does it mean to govern and make decisions together? And how do we think about that differently outside the frame of, you know, a more white patriarchal model? And Isabel, you know, we've been doing that for a little while. Do you have thoughts to share about what that's been like for you?
Yeah, I'm really grateful. One of our board members brought to us a different framework, an alternative to Robert's rules called dynamic governance. There's another word for it, sociocracy. And so we've been practicing it at the UU Women's Federation board. We're learning it. We're all learning how to do it. But it's an alternative way of talking with each other and making decisions. It's based in rounds. So everybody speaks on a topic before anybody speaks a second time. So it's a way to lift, to bring forward voices of people who tend to be quieter, and it gives an opportunity to the people who tend to speak a lot to listen. It gives them some structure so that they can feel comfortable just listening. The Unitarian Universalist world is starting to practice this more generally, and I encountered it also through a congregational life program that got together people from different congregations over Zoom to research how are we going to do church now that we have this pandemic. And this was right during the transition of power year and a half ago. And so I was able to learn some facilitation skills with this, and getting people from different congregations talking to each other and making decisions about things they all wanted to try in their congregations, and then come back together and talk about it, see how it went. We all listened to each other, and everybody loved it. They really got to know people and congregations in different parts of the country. So it's been really great with the UWF to practice it with people that I know well, and kind of try out our muscles on a new way of talking with each other and listening to each other. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to put in a plug, if you're curious about this, the racial justice team that's meeting this afternoon, we're going to be trying out some dynamic governance today in the way we're facilitating the meeting. So, Anne, I wanted to shift us into a conversation about the UU Women's Federation mission, because I think it's really powerful and might be inspiring to the folks here in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. I have it written here, so I'm going to read it. We came up with this all together with Anne when Anne joined us. So the UUWF builds covenantal relationships among UU women that equip us all to be better co-conspirators and allies in the movement for collective liberation. So I can talk at length about different parts of this mission, but Anne, I wonder if you have any things that are coming to you that you might want to share now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the one of the things that I love about this vision and this mission is that it places us in what I consider to be right relationship in terms of us all being learners and learning together and teaching each other how to think about doing the world differently. And as I said earlier, I think it also implies really lifting up emerging leaders and new thinkers and new voices, and getting out of their way and supporting that leadership and that their approaches, rather than just staying in our lanes that we've kind of created ruts for ourselves in. And so I find that really inspiring and exciting. And I think it allows us to explore some of the questions that we've had around the distinction between feminism and womanism, for instance, and what both intended and unintended harms white feminism has caused, and how we can heal and move forward from those things and create a more expansive sisterhood, both in the faith and beyond. And so I think we're thinking about how to more actively support congregations in this kind of work. We're going to be hiring an organizer so that we have expanded capacity to do that and build relationships both with congregations and not, and also with other partners who are working for justice, and find ways to expand and magnify their work and contribute to that work. And yeah, so those are some of the things that come to mind about, I too could go on and on about it, because it's just really an exciting, it's an exciting premise for me, and I feel really lucky to be a part of it. But those are some of the things that come to mind to me this morning.
I mean, it's just objectively awesome, but there's something about being a part of writing a mission with a group of people that really builds a sense of investment. And I know I've felt that here at the fellowship as people have talked about the mission and vision that came together here a few years ago, that it was a really exciting process for the people who engaged in it. So the thing that really stands out to me in it is this, that we build covenantal relationships among UU women. And I think the covenantal foundation of our faith and our relationships is something really powerful that Unitarian Universalism offers. And it's something we do just in our everyday interactions, sort of remembering the promises we have to each other. But in Unitarian Universalist community, we have the opportunity to be explicit about that and come together in a spiritual or sacred space to clarify and remember, and we be silent as we remember and ground in our covenantal connections. We, you know, as we're working on this land acknowledgement here, there's a promise we know we want to make in there, a covenant we want to make with each other and with the world to be accountable. And that's something we're growing into and growing toward. And so that covenantal basis, I think that's something that women, all humans have. And there's something about sisterhood, that there's some wisdom in there that that women's leadership can bring forward and has brought forward throughout history. I wonder, you know, we've been talking about the EU Women's Federation. I wonder, Anne, if you would share our history with the folks here who don't know much about it.
Sure, sure. So the UU Women's Federation formed in 1963, but it was a consolidation of two groups that were started in the late 1800s in recognition that women did not have access to power and decision-making in the denomination, and didn't have access to the financial resources to do their work that the more traditional acknowledged folks in power did. And so we made our own. And we collected our own. And that has been our legacy. There's an endowment that funds the Women's Federation, along with, we do have, you know, also have individual donors who give to the Federation, but we have an endowment that comes from that history of creating our own resources, women's own resources, to do the work that we feel is important and to cultivate leadership in the denomination. And, you know, I think just to riff off of what you were saying, Isabel, I think in addition to it being really a powerful place and opportunity for women to build a different world, I think it's important to also note, just as with white supremacy, both white supremacy and misogyny harm men and harm white folks too. And so we're not just expanding the opportunity for healing and change for women, it's actually for everybody. Because when we're put in a box and we're taught that we can only conduct ourselves in a certain way, that shuts down all kinds of opportunity and joy and life. And, you know, when we talk about relationship, I think one of the things that white supremacy and patriarchy does is diminish our ability to build rich relationship. And so I feel really strongly about covenantal relationships with among women. And I also believe that it's not just for women to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. I was going to ask you, what is the role of people who don't identify as women in feminism? And I feel like you've started to answer that. I mean, part of the role is to realize that we're all in it together, to realize that it's not, you know, women's issues aren't just women's issues, they're human issues, human rights issues. What else could you say about the role of people who are not women in feminism?
Yeah, I think the first thing is always to listen, and to believe us. Those are the two big first steps: listen to us and believe us. And I also think act, right? It's not enough to listen to us and believe us unless you are willing to act, and act in a way that, you know, that is a risk for you too, not just when it's safe. You know, when I think about, for instance, the threat that we are facing for women's reproductive rights in this country today, there are plenty of men who've benefited from women having access to reproductive freedom. And it's time those men stood up and said so too.
Yeah, thank you. Well, I'm feeling like this conversation has opened up a lot of thoughts for me and more questions for me. And I'm really curious to hear any feedback from folks. So after the service, I would love to chat with people, anything that's on your heart. And Ann will be there in Zoom land if folks have any questions or want to have a conversation. So I think we'll wrap up for now. I wonder, Ann, if you have any concluding thoughts or any final things you'd like to share with us?
I have a lot of gratitude for you creating space for this conversation, and I'd love to continue to have it. So I really invite folks to join us on this journey. And as I said, we think of ourselves as learners, and so I learn every time, and I'm learning right now as we're having this conversation. And so thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for being here and for being a leader and an organizer in our movement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
So seeing as we're here at noon, I'm gonna postpone our last song and invite Cathy back to give us our closing words.
Okay. All right. I apologize, I have come through and it turned off my video. Sorry about that. Okay, this is from Abigail Adams to John Adams. Note the date, March 31st, 1776. I long to hear that you have declared an independency, and by the way, in the new code of laws, which I suppose it will be necessary for you to make, I desire you would remember the ladies and be more generous and favorable to them than your ancestors. Do not put such unlimited power into the hands of the husbands. Remember, all men would be tyrants if they could. If particular care and attention is not paid to the ladies, we are determined to foment a rebellion and will not hold ourselves bound by any laws in which we have no voice or representation. So thank you, Abigail Adams, for opening our history with words leading to all who seek a more generous and favorable culture with one voice and representation for all. So have a beautiful Sunday and happy spring. Thank you. Goodbye.